I started printing when I was 14. My dad, who was the district attorney, had written the language for the Miranda warning. I was number 4 of 8. My job was to run imprints on little plastic Miranda warning cards that he created, and they went all over the United States. So as a 14-year-old young girl, I ran a Linotype and I ran a hand-fed Chandler and Price. My oldest sister did the books, my next sister took care of shipping, and over the years, each one of the kids in my family, my siblings, have had a little bit of something to do with what happens out here in the print shop. My dad's business was different than mine. He had a line of evidence tagging items that were imprinted for different police departments. And he also started acquiring monotype typecasters when the cold type came on board. And he started collecting this typecasting equipment. He began casting type to do limited edition books. So after my initial years of doing imprinting on these police evidence items, I then moved into correcting by hand monotype cast books and helping run them on the cylinder press downstairs. He did limited editions of a number of different books and they sold to private libraries. When I was 24, I was ready to move beyond Nevada City. I went not very far, but down to Sacramento. And when I was in Sacramento, I worked in some small print shops because that was what I knew how to do. I did get a job as a maid for about a week. And then I realized maybe I do like to print. It didn't really work out, me being a maid. I started into my career outside of this shop and I began to learn what it was like to work in other shops. I eventually worked in a print shop in Sacramento for 13 years and it had 29 men and myself in the press room. I earned many stripes working with all those men and came back up here in 1991 to start my own business. And I named it Full Circle Press because of the journey I had been on many levels. What has kept my interest in the letterpress field is the clients I get to work with. I just am thrilled with the people I have the opportunity to work with and meeting the needs that they have. I have a very high-end group of people that I work with. They have a very specific outcome they're looking for. And over the years, I've learned to add my creativity and the creativity of my team to their vision, and the outcome is a project that everyone's happy with. We are proud of everything we do. We have clients that have come back for all the years that I've been in business. When I first came up to Nevada City and started my business, there was like the first resurgence of letterpress printing. And for me, it had never gone away. I just always knew it was there. But all of a sudden, there was a little more awareness in the world of the design community. And at that time, there were not a lot of people who had knowledge about how to run the letterpress equipment, who were also connected specifically with the world of graphic designers. And that has become the market that I have stayed in. It sets me apart from people who have acquired letterpress equipment and do their own production and make greeting cards or a variety of different items that they produce and sell. The direction we go in is more as a commercial letterpress printer, fulfilling the vision of the people that we work with. Collaborations are one of my favorite things. They bring a lot of people from different areas of print together, and as a result, we all get to exercise in ways that we maybe wouldn't have. Some of my favorite projects have been in combination with design firms, paper companies, whoever we can kind of pull in and bring together to create something. A great example is an advent calendar. And I said, well, I'd like to do an advent calendar. And what the design firm came up with was so far from what I had imagined and so much better. He came up with this great idea that you could kind of create your own calendar, picking a theme. And it was really awesome. And then we go out to the paper companies, show them what we've created, see if they want to use that as their Christmas card. And 9 times out of 10, they do. And sometimes they even decide they want to buy over so that they can hand them out as promotionals. Letterpress printing really is equipment and what the equipment can do. What we do for the most part is put ink on paper. And unlike other printing equipment that is on the market, our printing has a more textural quality to it. We can print on heavier papers. We can make the outcome of a job have a very different kind of effect depending on the image and the paper that we're printing on. Most everything in today's world is very flat, and actually, if you're lucky, it goes onto paper. A lot of people spend their days looking at computer screens, and so when they actually have a piece, an invitation, a coaster, a business card that's handed to them that has been printed letterpress, they tend to keep it because it's like a special little gift. And it makes us really happy that people just love it. For me, it has been just the background of my whole life. I really can't remember not having printing in my life. Before I started printing in this shop, my dad had a print shop in downtown Nevada City, where Friar Tuck's is today. And he printed Catholic greeting cards, holy cards. And I can remember going down as a little girl and running my finger on the gold dust. And it was like fairy dust. And I just was fascinated with it. And the big machinery, I just loved it. So it really has been a part of my background. My dad, his first love was printing. He loved typography. He loved anything to do with printing. And sometimes I'll tell people where a lot of people's parents maybe collected spoons or postcards from around the world, Dad collected printing equipment. And as a result, we had a lot of printing equipment. Like any kid, I didn't know it was that different. I now realize how special and what a gift it has been. I think that more people are recognizing when they find that old little tiny letterpress in their grandpa's basement when they're cleaning it out. They take it, they decide they want to be the stewards of that equipment and carry it on somehow, and so they bring it back out. And there's a whole new respect. This is equipment that they stopped making probably in the 70s. You can get special equipment still made for you, but you would have to have a lot of money and be incredibly driven to actually follow through on that. We recently had a little event up here, and one of the guys just had a printing press made for himself. He was very proud, and he should be. Just like with classic cars or classic car shows, there are a whole group of people who love their letterpress equipment and will talk about it 24/7 if you're willing to listen. We're really kind of printing geeks. We like to talk about the nuts and bolts. We like to talk about where we got our first press. And men in particular like to talk about all the specs. They know where every setting's supposed to be. And women tend to talk about it like they adopted a baby. It's really interesting to see how people arrived at where they're at with their printing equipment. And the unique way that people have of presenting what they can create on the equipment they have. I'm amazed at what people can do with very little equipment. I've just always loved printing, and I've liked the people that have come into my life on account of it. Now that I am in the hierarchy of the print world, I recognize I have a lot to share. And so I would say my more current passion has become my interest in picking the people that I want to share it with. And I'm particularly devoted to having local people come on board and learn about printing. Brianna is a great example of just kind of intuitively knowing this is going to be a good fit. We have a really amazing team pulled together here. In my family, there's 8 children, there's 17 grandchildren for my mom, and so I have 15 nieces and nephews, and the nieces and nephews love to come out and see Aunt Judith. I actually have been able to carve really nice adult relationships with them. They, you know, the first business, their first batch of business cards, they come to Aunt Judith. They come to me when they want things to hang up in their dorm room. It has also been a way for them to make money when they come to visit, and they are going to go to the county fair or any number of things. Most recently, this last summer, Ruby, who is 11, came out and announced that she was B-R-O-K-E broke and she was going to go shopping in an hour. Could she work for me for an hour? So there's always some sort of a little project that I can bring up. It gives them a sense of being a part of, which I really, really think is so important, because my whole family, we just love that this is part of our life. It's a long learning curve. There are so many combinations of different things that can happen. I think that the learning curve has been set out for me by the people that I work with. They hold the bar high. For the most part, I can judge from the beginning of a project what's gonna happen. I can say this is gonna work or that's gonna work. However, there are always exceptions. And sometimes I have clients who are willing to go along for the ride, whatever it's going to be. I know I can do it, and I know I can get the job done, but I can't say it's going to look a certain way. So frequently we have people who come up on press checks. We encourage press checks because it gives people an opportunity to be a part of what we're doing and their project, and we just about need to push them out the door when we're done. We had a great couple up here from Berkeley this weekend, and they were so happy to be here and watch their wedding invitations be run. It was really, really great. And having a place like Nevada City to say, well, you know, why don't you guys go to lunch now while I finish running this? Liz took this particular couple into Nevada City, and they weren't prepared, is what they said when they came back. They had no idea. I feel really lucky to be able to have the kinds of clients I have and to be able to live in the place that we live and bring dollars into the community that wouldn't be here if we weren't doing this. And by hiring local people, the money is spent here. It's as good as it gets. When people call me up, they're ready to collaborate. They know it's going to be an experience, and they don't usually have 100% planned outcome, which is great. Sometimes we might need to shift color to actually make the job look better, and I'm never afraid to tell people. I also frequently run into people want to print a job letterpress, but then they need to design for letterpress. And I'm the last person to tell a designer their job isn't good. It's a good job. It may just not be the right fit for our shop and the equipment that we have, because the kind of letterpress printing that you see out in the world today is also equipment driven. If I had a Hummer, I could drive up the side of a cliff, but I'm not going to be able to do that in my Lexus. And so this is what I have to tell people. I realize you found this, you want to print at letterpress, but you know what? We don't have the Hummer. And you're going to need to go somewhere that they have that. And I can also tell people how to redesign or kind of nudge the design in a way that it will work well here. I feel fortunate that it is very much a collaboration when we work on a project. For us, it is. We probably spend too much time on the phone. Too much time talking to them about it, but that's just what we do. There's a lot of hand-holding that goes on when somebody decides that they want to pay the high dollar and also have their project really present who they are. There are a lot of options out there, so when they pick us, we really like to take care of them. Sometimes it is more about helping the client understand that they can relax and the job is going to be beautiful. So we frequently have projects in the shop that either they can come up on a press check and take a look at it, or we can put it on press and send samples to them. We have a job that needs to be in Florida by next week. So what we'll do is we'll put it on the press, we'll send a sample out to Florida, and they'll have it by 9:30 our time, and we can go ahead, come into work and run the job. I'm sure they're going to like it. It's just that they're not so sure. It's a big job. We want them to be confident when it's running. They need that reassurance. When I'm running a job, when I'm actually on press with a job, and I think I speak for Brianna too, I have to get my head really wrapped around it. And so I really like to be focused and not have to do anything else. Typically, because I also am the owner, I've seen the job long before it hits the press room. I've talked to the customer. I have a good idea of what it is they're wanting to achieve. And hopefully I've written it all down. We've gone through a couple of different functions. We're in the press room, which is really where the rubber meets the road. And I kind of get into a zone. And I really like to be able to stay in that zone. And I get my head wrapped around a job. Someone came in and interrupted me a couple weeks ago, and I said, you know, really, it's like texting and driving. I can't do this. I want to be really single-minded, and that's how we maintain consistency, and that's why we have the clients that we have. Usually we'll have a little conversation about it, and typically I'll know if we need to compensate a little bit on the ink one way or the other. There's usually some kind of intuitive ideas that I have about the project that we put into production, and Brianna and I might talk about what those are. We also discuss them at the beginning. When the job's coming in, Liz will come in and talk to me. When Bev is running film and setting the files up, we talk about what we're going to need to do to have the outcome that we want. Sometimes we might run one color in two different passes or on two different presses because we don't want the integrity of one image to be compensated by another. So we just make the choice that we're going to divide those two images, and maybe nobody ever knows what we did. They just know it looks good in the end. There are certain jobs that come in and they just kind of come in and go through really easy, and then there's other jobs where I feel like I want to talk to the customer, because in today's world of business, the climate is such that there are people who would be really willing to just do emails and go through the whole process that way. I like to talk to people on the phone. I like to hear their voice. I like to have them say out loud what it is that they're expecting, because there's a lot that can be either caught ahead of time so that there are no disappointments and everybody's happy with what happens. I want to have that connection with the customer because it's important to me. And I tend to carry that through the whole project. I have people that I have worked with enough times that I know when I can call the job that we've, you know, that's it, that's where we want to go. And I can't really explain it in words. I just know that they'll be happy and we can run with it. On occasion, I'll go back and for one reason or another, I have to go back rifling through everything I did in the last 21 years. And it's really amazing to me the beautiful projects that have come our way, and each one of them brings up a feeling in me. I can remember the client. I can barely remember what I had for dinner last night, but I can remember the colors of your logo. And so there's certain details that I do hold on to, and there's certain jobs that for whatever reason they just hit the mark, and I can't even say what it is. There's a way that you can create the ups and downs in the paper that really make the process shine, should that be your desired outcome. It's all about the paper, the image, the ink colors, or lack of ink colors. I really love what I do. It is a pleasure. Some projects are so complicated and trying at the time that I know in a year, if you ask me about that project, I'm going to tell you, I love it. People will say, well, what fun stuff are you working on? And I'm like, I can't really think of anything right now. When it's in my rearview mirror for a while, I look at it and I go, you know, that was really awesome. When we're actually running the job, it becomes us. We care so much about the people that we work with and about what we do. Everyone who's here has a lot of intention. And we're not here by accident. We're here because we want to be here. When we are working with somebody on their job, we are willing to hold their hand and take them through the process. And we'll send them a little short little video clip of their job running, and they just love it. There's ways that you can take care of people that make them feel special, and they are special to us. We are very attached to the people we work with. And we're very attached to each other as a team. So what's going to happen, Brianna, when this project comes in here is on the green side, we're running one color of brown. And that brown is going to match this brown. And we are also, we have to coordinate the whole piece with this envelope liner. So if I put this on the inside, that to me looks like it's going to match really well. They were trying to match the green, and I realized that the green would never really match with the paper. So I was able to talk them into this other concept. Mm-hmm. So there we have the envelope, and we will be printing on this paper. And I want you to be really careful because the green could rub off. So the reason we didn't run this here really is because we could never carry a solid. Litho presses have about an 1/8 inch stripe when they have contact with the paper. Ours are platen presses, and it just would never carry that even kind of look. So these people want these in Florida by next Monday. So we're gonna have to stay focused and really work hard on getting this printed. This particular project was actually a project that came to us through a company called A Day in May. And we collaborate with A Day in May all the time. We actually have these on our Etsy site. And it's amazing, people love these. The reason it's so successful is because there's enough white space to allow the paper to come up and the print to go down. If it was a solid, that couldn't occur. And because they design for letterpress all the time, they know what will work and what won't work. And you kind of have to have that white space in there so that that can happen. And people do. I mean, they pick it up and they hold it. And this is the thing they're not going to throw away. They might not even let somebody put their drink on it. So one of the things I can tell you is that when we print business cards, people have called 10 years later with a business card that they had printed letterpress. And they haven't thrown it out. And it's because it has that special quality, and that the person who's holding it might not know that it was done letterpress at the time. They just know that it's more special than the other ones, and they're not gonna throw it away. And so that's kind of the edge that we have. It makes letterpress printing unique. And I think when you know what's going to work, you begin to create that. This is another one where we worked mostly with a type. And this was for our special day when we had all of the printers together. We called it our All-Star Printers Day. And Liz and Bev set up the design. So we designed this internally. And we put everybody's name around the outside edge. And we knew ahead of time that it would look really rockin'. I have two children. They love what I do, and they're very supportive. My sweetie is amazingly supportive of what I do. Printing really is my life. I also go to a lot of music events. And I am a pretty active person just locally. I like to be involved. People are what I love, how they act, what they do. We had an event a couple weeks ago, and it was really important to all of us. What we did was we had a person who was visiting from Alabama, Amos Kennedy, who was a fairly well-known poster maker, and a woman, Mary Bruno, from Minnesota, and they wanted to come out and just kind of walk around and watch what we do for a week, which we were like, why would anyone want to do that? But they wanted to, so we said, okay. And because they were here, we pulled together a very special group of people that would not normally have gotten together. And it was a pretty amazing day. Everyone was so very happy. We ended the day at the hospitality house empty bowl meal. Everyone had sent their $20 up so that we could all go in together and pick out our bowls that we could take back as souvenirs of the day. And it was really, really fun. The way people interact means a lot to me. And even more so, I think, as I move forward into the future, gathering groups of people together that create a better world is really important to me. This one here, you know what I'm looking at? It's like that one. Did those? Looks like the red's a little bit in. Do you think they'll notice? Thank you.